Well, the story really begins when I was doing my MBA in 1965, and Rod Carnegie, who had come home to Australia to live and open McKinsey's office, came up to the business school, and he said to us that if any of you, there are 18 of us, if any of you expect to work for McKinsey, you'd have to finish in the top 5% of your class. Well, fortunately, I finished up second in the whole course, got interviewed by Rod Carnegie and was employed by McKinsey in early 66. 2 weeks later, I was in New York doing courses with McKinsey. I had a wonderful 6 years there, met some outstanding people. And the point was, McKinsey solved top management problems with the chief executives of big corporations. So I got the best experience of my life. By 1969, I was sent back to Chicago for 2 years, where I worked with a big diversified retailer called Gamble Skogman. I worked with the chief executive, Jim Watson, and he and I became very, very close friends. He only died in 2010 and did come out to Australia for one of our great sessions at the Foster's Melbourne Cup. The work I did with him, he did talk to me and wanted me to stay on and become a permanent resident of the United States. I didn't want to do that. I wanted to bring my children up in Australia. So when I told him I was going home, he said, well, are you going to stay consulting? I said, no, I think I'm getting sick of consulting. I'd really love to run my own business. I'd love to buy a badly managed business in Australia, and there were plenty of them. And he said, if you want to do that, I'll support you with $10 million. Well, that gave me a lot of heart, and when I got back to Australia to attend, both my brothers were getting married in December 1970, I started to think very seriously about how I would go about building the company that could do the takeover, etc. Now, it turned out that the contacts I'd made in Australia before I went over, Sir Ian McLennan, Mr. Stephen Kimpton, Rod Carnegie, who had started a small merchant bank with Bailey Meyer, and they both introduced me to the Darling family. It gave me a great set of contacts to put my proposal. And all I sought was $100,000, quite a bit of money in those days, so that I could research all of the small public companies who were badly run. I finished up covering over 300 of them, and after I reviewed every balance sheet out of Roach Tilley's stockbroking business where I had an office, I kept coming back all the time to Henry Jones. Now, I'd originally told my backers that I would be looking for a company with the order of 15 million. Henry Jones had a market capitalization of 32 million. But I kept going round and round and round. It was clearly the best buy. Now, from my McKinsey days, I hadn't told a soul what company I was looking at. And I knew that I would have to go and speak to the chief executive. And prior to that, Stephen Kimpton had introduced me to the Commercial Bank of Australia, and this was their head office where we're sitting today. Elders, the stock and station business in Adelaide, and National Mutual. He was on the board of all these companies. And they became my backers, and I didn't ever use Jim Watson's money. There was one reason I didn't do that, because back in those days, the FIRB, which controlled foreign ownership of Australian businesses, it was a very controversial policy, and nothing could be bought in Australia without permission. And I didn't want to have so much US money in the company that I couldn't proceed without going to the FIRB. So that's where we started, and I decided on the floor above this wonderful headquarters was Doug Stride. He was chief executive of the CBA Bank. I went and told him, and I was somewhat concerned because Henry Jones, being a very diversified fruit, jam and other food products, big manufacturer all over Australia, no one controlled it. But the CBA Bank was its banker in Victoria, so I was somewhat concerned that the Conservative Bank might knock it on the head. I went and saw Doug Stride on my own. I told him the name of the company, and he said, John, that's a very, very good choice. They need a lot of help. So then we're away, and I raised $5 or $6 million from my backers. We bought a stake in Henry Jones quietly. For the first time in Australia, I used two different brokers. One, my great friend Peter Lawrence, who was at Roach Tilley, and the other one, my friend from the university, Bob Cowper. So it didn't become quite as obvious that only one I was buying through two different brokers. We got the 5%. We then worked out, and I put the proposal to my backers that we wanted to buy half of Henry Jones. The code name was Taking Tiger by the Tail, and we went through it with all our shareholders. Everybody agreed. The money was put in place, $6 million of equity, $14 million of debt, and we made a bid for half of Henry Jones. Richard Wiesner, who became my finance director, basically said he was going to join me as finance director. We made the bid, and the merchant bank out of Sydney representing Henry Jones was known to Richard Wiesner. He was very friendly with the principal. Basically, Henry Jones were advised that we should bid for the lot. We didn't want to. Doug Stride of the CBA Bank said, I'll put up the rest of the money. So we had $36 million in place, of which 30 was debt. We bid for 100% of Henry Jones, telling the shareholders, please stay in. We finished up getting 72%, and in December 1972, we took over control. Richard Wiesner left McKinsey, and he and I went off to South Africa, which have a good review of our best business. That's where it all started, and obviously then we had to hunt around for a good marketing executive, and we took probably the best young executive in marketing from the Heinz Company, none other than Peter Scanlon. Well, that was the start. Next week, I'll talk about more of the progress, and there'll be plenty of humorous anecdotes.